Welcome to A Bit More Yorkshire Brass with me, David Hoyle, on Remembrance Weekend. Thanks for joining me as usual. This week's programme, very much in two halves. Our Remembrance tribute in the first part, and requests as usual in the second. Today we pay tribute to those who served their country and those who we remember. We're doing so with a series of stirring marches, followed by a reflective section of hymns and solemn music. We bring the hour to an end with the bugle calls. One of the most stirring marches ever written, and one used regularly at remembrance festivals and march pasts. That march was called Fame and Glory. It was written by Albert Matt and played there by the Fairy Band. It was published in 1924, and by tradition it's played first in order at the Veterans March Past at the Cenotaph on London's Whitehall on Remembrance Sunday. It's a great honour for me personally to attend the Festival of Remembrance at the Royal Albert Hall each year to pay respects to those who lost their lives while serving their country. Sadly, I can't do that this year, but nevertheless, I've got lots of memories of what is a moving occasion, and there's also very much a sense of pride. The music is a mixture of uplifting marches and pensive hymn tunes, and this march coming up now is used as part of the muster during the event. The Brickhouse and Rastrick Band play Ballycastle Bay. This march was written in 1889 in Ulm in Germany by military music composer Karl Tyker. Tyker wrote many pieces for marching band, and when bringing this newly composed march to the regiment, the Kapellmeister simply told him, "We've got plenty enough of this type of musical march, put this one in the oven." This episode eventually led to Tyker taking leave of the band and naming the march as Alte Kameraden. Tyker later worked as a police officer, but also continued composing military marches and eventually wrote around 100. This one is right up there as one of the very best. The Brickhouse and Rastrick Band play Old Comrades. Royal British Legion are responsible for the excellent organisation of the annual Festival of Remembrance. As I say, sadly this year it's not to be, but nevertheless, we can still offer our tribute online. The next march is always played at the Royal Albert Hall to thank the Royal British Legion for their efforts and to signal the arrival of their standard bearers into the arena. This march was composed by Thomas Bidgood and it's played here by the British Airways Band, the Royal British Legion March. The Royal British Legion typically distribute over 40 million poppies on an annual basis. The poppy has a long association with Remembrance Day, but how did the distinctive red flower become such a potent symbol of our remembrance of the sacrifices made in past wars? Scarlet corn poppies grow naturally in conditions of disturbed earth throughout Western Europe. The destruction brought about by the Napoleonic Wars of the early 19th century transformed the bare land into fields of blood-red poppies growing around the bodies of the fallen soldiers. In late 1914, the fields of northern France and Flanders were once again ripped open as World War I raged through Europe's heart. Once the conflict was over, the poppy was one of the only plants to grow on the otherwise barren battlefields. The significance of the poppy as a lasting memorial symbol to the fallen was realised by the Canadian surgeon John McCrae in his poem In Flanders Fields. The poppy came to represent the immeasurable sacrifice made by his comrades and quickly became a lasting memorial to those who died in World War I and in later conflicts. It was adopted by the Royal British Legion as the symbol for their poppy appeal, in aid of those serving in the British Armed Forces after its formation in 1921. Next up, a slow march composed during 1881 with music by Irishman Edward Slater. This is a march that is always played in Britain at the annual Festival of Remembrance and at the Cenotaph on Remembrance Sunday when the Chelsea Pensioners march. One of my favourites, the David Urquhart Travel Yorkshire Imperial Band play the Boys of the Old Brigade. Next up is the official march of the Royal Air Force, the RAF, and it's used also in some other Commonwealth Air Forces. The original score was completed by Walford Davies in 1918 for the new RAF. It combined the rhythm of the bugle call of the Royal Flying Corps with that of the Royal Naval Air Service. The call appears in both the introduction and in the coda. It was originally known as Ad Astral 1 in reference to the RAF's motto. The second part of the march past the trio was composed by Sir George Dyson. The Roberts Bakery Band played the RAF March Past.
Thank you.
Our next march was written in the middle of World War I in 1916 by the brilliant English march composer Kenneth J. Alford, his proper name Frederick Joseph Ricketts. This march exemplifies the qualities of those who eventually brought victory to the Western Front in France, those who bore the brunt of all that the enemy could throw against them, and originally hated by the enemy and described by them as the contemptible little army. The Brick House and Rastrick Band bring the march section to an end as they play The Great Little Army. We move now from the march section and onto a montage of wartime music. This is a tribute to all of those who fought for their country. It's fitting that the band playing here is the oldest brass band in the world. Their name is the Stalybridge Old Band, and they were formed way back in 1809. Jack Judge made this arrangement called Tipperary. Thank you. We move now to the hymn tune section, and a lovely Welsh piece of music dating back to the early 1700s. The story goes that the tune was composed by David Owen, who was a harpist and composer. He lived near Porthmadog in Carnarvonshire, and he was known locally as David of the White Rock, Y Gara Gwen. The White Rock was the name of the farm where he lived. As Owen lay on his deathbed, he called for his harp and he composed the tune of the haunting song. He sadly died at the age of 29 and was buried at a church near Porthmadog in North Wales. Let's hear David of the White Rock by the Black Dyke Mills Band. We move on now to a hymn traditionally associated with seafarers, particularly in the maritime armed services. This hymn was written in 1860. Its author, William Whiting, was inspired by the dangers of the sea described in Psalm 107. It was popularised by the Royal Navy and the United States Navy in the late 19th century, and variations of it were soon adopted by many branches of the armed services in the United Kingdom and the United States. Services who have adopted the hymn include the Royal Marines, the Royal Air Force, the British Army, the United States Coast Guard, and the United States Marine Corps, as well as many of the navies of the British Commonwealth. Accordingly, it is known by many names, variously referred to as the Hymn of Her Majesty's Armed Forces, the Royal Navy Hymn, the United States Navy Hymn, or just simply the Navy Hymn, and sometimes by the last line of its first verse, "For those in peril on the sea." The hymn has a long tradition in civilian maritime contexts as well, being regularly invoked by ships' chaplains and sung during services on ocean crossings. Melita is its title on this recording by the Lindley Band, but its most used title is Eternal Father, Strong to Save. Now, another hymn written by a man who was in dire health at the time of writing. It's a Christian hymn by Scottish Anglian Henry Francis Light, often sung to English composer William Henry Monk's tune titled Eventide. Light wrote the poem in 1847 and set it to music while he lay dying from tuberculosis. He survived only a further 3 weeks after its completion. This super arrangement by Gough Richards is played by the Black Dyke Band, and it's stirring to say the least. Abide with me. We go now from the stirring passion of Abide With Me to something on the other side of the scale. When it comes to thought-provoking music for Remembrance Sunday, this piece has to be the best candidate for that title. Sir Edward Elgar's Enigma Variations has 14 movements, but variation number 9 is definitely the most played. It's used at state funerals, memorial services, and other solemn occasions as a chance for listeners to reflect, and it does that perfectly. It is always played at the Cenotaph in London on Remembrance Sunday and was used at the end of the 2017 film Dunkirk. The Grimthorpe Colliery Band play Nimrod. And now to the bugle call. Also known as the retreat call, this is a bugle call played in the United Kingdom and British Commonwealth countries to signal the end of the official military day. In common with all bugle calls, it consists only of notes from a single overtone series, which allows it to be playable on a bugle or equivalently on a cornet without moving the valves. The music was composed aboard HMS Queen Elizabeth in response to Admiral Fisher's desire for a spectacular show, and it was first performed in 1932 by the mass bands and bugles of the Mediterranean Fleet. The sunset call is now a regular part of the Royal Marines' Beat the Retreat ceremony. The call's melody also gives its name to sunset parades, given in commemoration of former military conflicts. It is traditional to stand for the performance of the piece. The Carlton Main Frickley Colliery Band play Sunset. We end our Remembrance Sunday tribute show now with a short poem, the Ode to Remembrance. This will be followed by a hymn tune intertwined with another bugle call, The Last Post. The Brickhouse and Rastrick Band are playing here. Graham McCulloch is the bugle caller. Nightfall in Camp is the title. Thank you for listening. They went with songs to the battle. They were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady and aglow. They were staunch to the end, against odds uncounted. They fell with their faces to the foe. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. The Brighouse and Rastrick Band playing Night Falling Camp by D.A. Pope, bringing to an end our Remembrance Tribute Hour on A Bit More Yorkshire Brass. The second hour of this week's programme, very much business as usual. Thanks for all your requests and your dedications. You really have picked some lovely stuff. We start off with a great piece of music for Michelle in Chorley. Michelle has requested this piece of music, which was written by Diego Ortiz and arranged for brass band by Simon Kerwin. It's played by the Scottish Co-op Band and it's called Risha Carter. The Scottish Co-op Band playing Simon Kerwin's arrangement of Diego Ortiz's Risha Carter. That was for Michelle in Chorley. That was known in our neck of the woods, that music, as Richard Carter. Quite a few people round our way call Richard Carter, and one of our old MDs used to call it that, just to let you know. Next up, another march. This is for Neil in Warwick.
My birthday is on the 12th of November, Ollie. Well, happy birthday to you, Neil in Warwick. And my favourite march reminds me of going to the Speedway when I was a lad. Yes, lots of people will associate this particular march with that. The Yorkshire Imperial Band are playing here. It's the music of Arnold Sofroni, Imperial Echoes. The Yorkshire Imperial Band playing the music of Arnold Sofroni. That match was called Imperial Echoes, and Neil in Warwick, your request. Self-indulgent, as Neil says, for my birthday. Happy birthday, my friend. Thank you very much indeed for getting in touch. yorkshirebrass@gmail.com, the email address that you used for that. Same email address used by Barry in Malton. Now then, Oily, says Barry, please call me Baz. Baz, how are you? Thank you very much indeed for sending in a request, which actually is going to be our heritage track of the week. This is a recording from 1967, and the Crossley's Carpet Works band are playing. John Harrison conducting on the recording. Barry says this is a cracker of an overture. It certainly is. It's a mucky brown paper moment. What's mucky brown paper? Well, it's music that's been in the brass band library for years. Sometimes it was on that sort of brownish coloured paper. Other times it's been in there, gone a bit damp, or it's been mounted on cardboard and the pigment from the cardboard's gone into the paper. Mucky brown paper, that's all. Nothing sinister, don't worry. Yes, so what is this wonderful overture? Well, it was written by Thomas Arne and arranged by William Rimmer for brass band. The Crossley's Carpet Works Band play Rule Britannia. Thank you. Great stuff. Our heritage recording of the week, the Crossless Carpet Works Band, playing William Rimmer's arrangement of Thomas Arne's overture, Rule Britannia. Good stuff, isn't it? I'll tell you something, that is not easy to play in terms of stamina. It's a bit of a blow, but very, very enjoyable indeed. I'm going to come on to this week's subject very shortly, which involves schools. But more of that after we've had the first solo spot. This is lovely. Sarah's been in touch and she says, my mum and dad, Michael and Hilary, are big fans of yours and they're celebrating their golden wedding mid-November. They would love to hear their names mentioned on the show. And it's a very straightforward request, says Sarah, because the title of the piece says it all. Happy golden wedding, mum and dad, Michael and Hilary, from Sarah and family. You're in Ilkley and you've asked for this piece. Well, Alan Witcherly on the soprano cornet, Nigel Lawless on the euphonium, duetting the Sellers Engineering Band with the accompaniment. Andrew Lloyd Webber's All I Ask of You. Thank you. Just wonderful, isn't it? The great sound of Alan Witcherley on soprano cornet, Nigel Lawless on the euphonium with the Sellers Engineering Band. Andrew Lloyd Webber's All I Ask of You. That was all Sarah asked of me for her mum and dad, Michael and Hilary, who are celebrating their golden wedding this week. Many, many congratulations to you both. Thanks so much for listening. I mentioned schools as a specialist subject, and somebody came on to me on the email, I think it was Ian actually, and he said, do you remember your formative school years, your infant and junior school? Oh, absolutely. Oh, yes. So many good memories. And Ian says, wouldn't it be great to share some of these with the listeners, what your memories are? Ian says, I've got my own memories, and no doubt some of yours, probably many of yours, are funny. Well, yeah, because you do remember the funny things, don't you? I'll just start off with two or three, and then we'll go on to some more music. But the knit nurse. You used to get a visit from the knit nurse, didn't you? And they used to put the fingers in your hair, well, when I had hair, and like, massage your head. And then all the mums were sort of outside at the end of the day. Have you got knits? Have you got knits? The school dentist. I used to hate when the school dentist came. They always seemed to say that you needed something doing. Let me say that I've, touch wood, I've had a really good set of teeth, and I never took any, well, my mum and dad never took any advice from the school dentist. We always went to our own dentist, who seemed to disagree with the school dentist. And it was a bit like that with brass lessons. There was a brass teacher came to our junior school. Of course, at that time, does anybody play a brass instrument? Yes, I play the cornet. Right, you can have lessons on Friday afternoons. That was all well and good until my teacher found out at band. You're not going to him. He'll give you bad habits. He'll give you bad habits. No, you can't. I forbid it. So I had to go back and say I didn't want any more lessons at school because this teacher actually conducted a rival band. It was a bit like that. Next up, what have we got? Oh, lovely. Mary in York, how are you doing? Mary says, is there a version of the Andrews Sisters song, Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy? For brass band, that's a right mouthful, isn't it? There is, actually. Ray Woodfield made an arrangement. And the music originally was by Don Ray and Huey Prince. And this just works so, so well for brass band. Mary, you're 85 on Tuesday. Bless you. Here we go. The Britannia Building Society Band with Ray Woodfield's arrangement of Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy. Thank you. Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy, Ray Woodfield's arrangement of the music of Don Ray and Huey Prince. Wonderful stuff from the Britannia Building Society Band as we wish Mary in York a very, very happy 85th birthday. Good on you, Flower. Now then, young Sam Dunn is up next from the Friesland Band. Sam says, we had an amazing couple of days in Saddleworth recently when the Grenadier Guards turned up. Yes, they've been before, haven't they, and marched through, I think it's up a mill where they march, and there's always lots of social media coverage of it, and some really, really lovely stuff, and the people around there really love their visits. They go to the local school as well. So all good stuff. Sam obviously really enjoyed it. He said, I would like you to play two pieces of music. Well, sadly, Sam, the first one, which is called General Mitchell, we don't appear to have a brass band version or recording of that piece of music. It must just be a military march. So I'm sorry we can't play that one. And similarly, the second march that you've asked for, we don't have just a march copy. It's part of a montage of famous British marches. In fact, it's the first piece on famous British marches by Gordon Langford. But what I thought I would do is play Gordon Langford's arrangement just of this particular piece on its own, if that's okay with you. Thanks again for your request. Hope all's going well at band. And here is the Black Dyke Mills Band playing Gordon Langford's The British Grenadiers. Gordon Langford's arrangement of the British Grenadiers was played by the Black Dyke Mills Band. Sam Dunn, a young man from the Friesland Band. Lovely to hear from you again, and thanks very much for your request. We're talking about schools this week. Ian said, how about talking about your infant and junior school days? What do I remember? I remember the Gibbs toothpaste in a tin. It was pink stuff. I used to like the taste of it, and you had to go and brush your teeth once a day in infant and junior school, and it was sort of in a smallish tin. You got your toothbrush out and took some of the stuff off. And yeah, it used to taste really nice. Gibbs toothpaste. I remember we did a series of lessons from a radio broadcast, and it was called Country Dancing. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed doing that, and it had a great theme tune. And I've looked for that theme tune for Yonks, because I think it would be great for a brass band to play. I can't even find any mention of the show online. But if anybody remembers Country Dancing, you know, you'll be in your mid-50s probably now. And that theme tune, I'd love to know what it was called and where I can find it. So there's a little thing that some of you can look at. And how about when you were in assembly? Well, two things in assembly. The first thing was that you used to sing hymns in the day, and the words were on a really, really big poster type thing, and there probably were 200 hymns all in this unit put together, and you used to find the hymn that you wanted, roll the pages over, and then it was lifted up the wall on a rope pulley so that everybody could read it. Obviously that doesn't happen anymore. And one of the other things I remember in assembly particularly, you'd be doing whatever you were doing, it may be a quiet moment, and then you just all of a sudden you'd hear this bang. Oh God, somebody's fainted again. And it was quite often the same people who fainted as well. Not mentioning any names, but one in particular. What's up next? Mark, how are you? A lovely email from overseas, here in Australia. It's my birthday mid-November, and I'd love to hear Vitae Lux, if at all possible. Absolutely no problem. This is the music of Torstein Aagaard Nielsen, arranged by Frodo Alnaesh. The band playing here is Pennine Brass. Thank you. Pennine Brass playing Vitae Lux by Torstein Aagaard Nielsen. Happy birthday to Mark, who is down under in Australia. Going back to schools again, we in the junior school, we had houses. You were in one of four houses. There was a red, there was a blue, there was a green and a yellow. Romans, Trojans, Spartans, Teutons. Romans were blue, Trojans were a sort of a maroony red colour, Spartans were green and Teutons were yellow. I was in Teutons, and it was, who was the house of the week? And they were like four shields, just in a pecking order, and being the top shield for the week was great, absolutely ace. Sadly, it doesn't happen anymore. I'm not going to say any more than that, but there's nothing wrong with a bit of competitiveness, you know, it works. Another great memory of junior school was the youth hostel trip. In your last year in the juniors, before you went to the high school, you had a 5-day, Monday to Friday trip. You went to stay in a youth hostel. We went to Ramsgill near Pateley Bridge, and we did lots of walking and exploring, and just spent time together. It was brill, absolutely. And the first time really, properly, that I'd been away from home without either of my parents with me. But yeah, it was good. And it whet the appetite for me to travel. And I've done, well, the rest of history personally away from band in 40 years in travel. Am I going to talk about food? Well, yeah, two things. Spam fritters. I used to absolutely adore spam fritters on school dinners. They were brilliant. And then most times on a Friday, it was fish and chips, which were fine, apart from the peas. The old farters, the mushy peas, were like bullets in our school. They never, ever cooked them right. And a lot of the time, they weren't thick enough. So you just got dumped on your plate, and all the juice went into the fish. And oh, no, just not right. We had one or two lovely dinner ladies in our school. And if you asked for more of something, because you like really liked it, they gave you less. And if you asked only for a bit of something, they gave you more. My brother had a great idea. He wasn't a big fan of veg. He hated turnip, as we called it then, Swede these days. And he didn't like cabbage either. And this one particular day, both were on the menu. So he went to the lovely dinner lady who used to chuck things on and said, "I really like turnip, miss. Can I have a lot?" And yeah, in typical fashion, she gave him the smallest spoonful of turnip. And then he said, "Cabbage." "Oh," he said, "cabbage, I ate that. Absolutely ate it." Well, she threw a load of that on. You were only allowed to leave one thing on your dinner plate. So my very crafty brother covered the turnip up with the cabbage and then said to the teacher, "Miss, I've left me cabbage." Wonderful. Fond memories of school. I've got two more after we've played this week's test piece. This is a belter. I played this test piece in the last contest held at Bellevue in Manchester in 1981. The Williams Ferry Engineering Band are playing here for Eddie in Horsforth. The music is by Eric Ball. This week's test piece, Tournament for Brass. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tournament for Brass by Eric Ball. This week's test piece was played by the Williams Fairey Engineering Band for Eddie in Horsforth. Eddie, thank you very much indeed. That came in via the Yorkshire Brass Facebook group. If you're not a member, pop onto Facebook, look for Yorkshire Brass. You'll find me and my pictures on there in various guises on brass band concerts and stuff like that. Send us a request to join the group and we'll add you in. There's some lovely stuff going in there. John Clark, regular listener and regular dog sitter. Young man, how are you? John says, I don't know if you've played this one recently. If I've missed it, I'm sorry for taking your time up. Don't ever think that. And we play this hymn many, many times on this show because it's so lovely. John says, I would like to hear the miners' hymn, Gresford, for my ex-mine worker friends here in North Leicestershire. It's a lovely, moving piece of music, and I know that Black Dyke have recorded it. They have indeed. This arrangement is by Sandy Smith, big friend of the show, and as John Clark rightly says, a lovely hymn tune. The Black Dyke Mills Band play Robert Saint's Gresford. Sandy Smith's arrangement of Robert Saint's hymn tune Gresford, the Miner's Hymn, requested by John Clark. Thanks again, John, and best wishes to you and your ex-mine worker friends in North Leicestershire. Let's finish off my little list now of things about schools. I've got three other things. Two of them kind of are linked together. One of my lasting memories of infant school was when my brother, who was 18 months younger than me, started school. I'd obviously been there for a length of time, and we went in, mum took us in, and the headmistress of the time was not elderly, but she was ready for retiring and did retire a couple of years after this happened. But on the first morning, early September, lots of crying youngsters didn't want to leave mum. I hadn't been to sort of playgroups in those days. You just went straight to school, really. And the headmistress, right, we'll have no hanky-panky. So there's all these kids crying, and she called it hanky-panky. How dare she? Just imagine if that happened now. We're having no hanky-panky. Mums, you can go. And that was it. They were off, gone. The last two subjects, I've got to talk about these because it just brings a wry smile every time I think about this. Milk at schools, milk monitors, they used to come in the blue crates with the little bottles, I think probably a half a pint, maybe even only a third of a pint, I can't just remember that bit. Anyway, you used to have your daily milk round about 10:30 in class, and it was either a green or a pink straw. The boys always wanted the green ones and the girls always wanted the pink ones. But at certain times there were no green straws available, so everybody had to have pink, and that was a bit of a thing with some of the boys. I don't know why, a straw's a straw really, isn't it? Anyway, you had your milk, bottles back into the crates, milk monitors then took the crates back towards the front door of the school, and outside they went for the milkman to take the next day. What quite often seemed to happen in our class is that within half an hour, 45 minutes of someone having the milk, they were sick. Everywhere. Oh God, it were awful, absolutely horrid. It used to stink, of course, because it was milk. And the caretaker sat there all day in the office. Right, I'm on my way. Came in with a silver bucket full of sand, or even wood shavings, and poured this stuff, this substance, on top of the pool of sick. I'll be back in 10 minutes to mop it all up once it's soaked in. So there you are in a lesson, and you're having to learn and do your bits. Well, there's this stuff on the floor, and as I say, it stunk, so there's half the kids in the class gipping themselves. Just, you never forget things like that, do you? Happy days, though. My school days were such happy, happy days. That brings another programme to an end. This was show number 133 with me, David Hoyle, a bit more Yorkshire Brass. Thanks so much for joining me. Kevin is in Elland and seeing us out this week with an absolute classic by the great Edward Elgar. James Ord Hume made the arrangement, and Kevin says, could I hear the Grimthorpe Colliery Band playing this particular piece of music? You can, absolutely. See you next week. Thanks again for joining me. And we finish today with Pomp and Circumstance March number 4. Thanks again. Ta-ra!